Hi, I'm Georg Sperl, and this is the presentation for the paper Estimation of Yarn Level Simulation Models for Production Fabrics. This is joint work together with Rosa Sánchez-Banderas, Manwen Lee, Chris Wojtan, and Miguel Otaduy. Yarn-based fabrics are mechanically complex. The various woven or knitted structures, the yarn material, and more can have a dramatic influence on how a fabric behaves. The yarn properties and intricacies of local yarn-yarn interactions non-trivially affect large-scale material properties, resulting in widely different stiffnesses, anisotropies, and more. Because of this complexity, we've seen a lot of research in computer graphics towards simulating fabrics as individual yarns. Remion et al. Introduced simulation of knits using splines. Calder et al. Improved on this with explicit contact handling at larger scales, and later merged the model with discrete elastic rods. Sirio et al. Proposed an efficient persistent contact formulation based on Eulerian on Lagrangian degrees of freedom, which was later extended to handle multiple layers of fabric by Sánchez-Banderas et al. Leaf et al. Used fast periodic yarn simulation for interactive design of woven and knitted patterns. While these works prove that yarn simulation can match the qualitative behavior of real fabric, could these elastic yarn models we've been using also capture the complexity found in real production fabrics used in the textile industry? Our goal is to find yarn material parameters such that a yarn level simulation would reproduce the large-scale fabric behavior quantitatively, with respect to physical measurements from standardized testing. This is a step towards creating predictive yarn level simulation models, which could open up novel applications in textile materials. However, estimating such models poses some interesting issues. Fitting yarn parameters by directly replicating the physical tests with yarn simulation is non-trivial, but also intractable. For example, the yarn simulation on the left would roughly represent only this tiny area in the actual test. A priori, it's also not clear if the ROT models mentioned previously are descriptive enough to reproduce the complexities of real data. While there is work on fitting thin shell cloth models from physical tests, we're interested in fitting the underlying yarn model. Similarly, there is previous work that estimates the forward transition from small rod or yarn structures to a large mechanical response, while we want to do the inverse, going from large-scale mechanics to small-scale parameters. We tackle this problem of quantitatively fitting yarn parameters with two contributions. First, we generate a database of 33 production knit fabrics, including physical stretching and bending measurements, as well as yarn composition data. Second, we introduce a two-step fitting procedure based on homogenization. We fit an intermediate shell model to the fabric data and use it to fit a modified yarn model in a computationally feasible way with small-scale periodic simulation. This way, we succeed in automatically and quantitatively capturing the fabric level response of a wide range of knit fabrics spanning different stiffnesses and anisotropies through yarn simulation. In the following, I'll provide details on both the fabric dataset and our two-step fitting process before discussing some key results. First, we'll talk about the dataset. There are some key challenges in designing a dataset for a problem of matching production fabrics via yarn simulation. While we could start with yarn-level data and then attempt to forward simulate the machine knitting process, there are too many unknowns, such as the forces applied by the needles, how the yarns deform plastically, and more. As a result, we can't really know the exact strains of yarns in a fabric. What makes this more difficult is that fabrics used in the textile industry commonly use composite yarns to tweak fabric stiffness or optics. In our dataset, more than half are so-called plaited fabrics, where multiple different yarns are overlaid on top of each other during knitting. In this example, we have a combination of a stiff polyester yarn and a compliant spandex yarn. This combination leads to some very interesting nonlinear composite yarn material, complicating the design or choice of yarn simulation models. Our solution to address these issues is to provide both yarn level and fabric level data. So next, we'll look at some of the data that we gathered for each of our fabric. To start with, since we have plaited fabrics using combinations of multiple yarns, we have data on the yarn composition. This includes the respective mass percentages, densities, and stiffnesses. Next, we have high-resolution photographs of the front and back of fabrics at rest. In the photos alone, it's difficult to see the exact topology of the yarns, since some of them are partially occluded. So we additionally provide schematic images that depict the pattern topology from the knitting program. For simulation, we'll need the yarn center lines, as in the photographs. Because those are difficult to trace, we used both sets of images and some interpolation for the occluded parts to register the center lines. To capture the in-plane and bending response over fabric, we have physical measurements from uniaxial stretching tests and pair-loop bending tests. There's tons more that I don't have the time to mention, but you can find all the details in the paper and supplementary. With the dataset ready, we can use it for our goal of fitting yarn material parameters to explain the large-scale response of real fabric. As mentioned before, because of the scale of fabric tests, it is not feasible to directly simulate those as yarns in an optimization context. It is also not trivial to accurately model the boundary conditions. The recent homogenization approaches can circumvent the scale issue by exploiting periodic simulation. In a nutshell, uniform strains are applied to geometry via periodic boundary conditions, and we can compute an average energy or stress to represent the large-scale behavior. But these approaches are limited to uniform deformation. While we find that stretched fabric often exhibits substantially non-uniform deformation, such as shearing near the clamps or curling at the boundary. We resolve these issues of non-uniformity and scale by using an intermediate thin shell model. We first fit a thin shell model to the three stretch directions. For this, we use a simulation in the loop optimization that minimizes the error in boundary clamp forces and orthogonal compression at equilibrium. The model we fit is a Saint-Venant-Kirchhoff model with Neo-Hokkien area preservation terms, which we found is a generally decent fit for knits. Now we use the fitted thin shell model to generate uniform strain data for the yarn fitting. We found it best to replicate the test setup with a free orthogonal boundary, meaning that we compare the thin shell model and the homogenized yarn simulations at a certain stretch with respect to their stretching stress and optimal orthogonal strain. The yarn fit directly optimizes only around 5 yarn material parameters, such as yarn stretching and bending stiffness. We still found that to avoid getting stuck in bad local minima, it was good to use global swarm optimization to find a good initial guess. And to avoid having to optimize hundreds of degrees of freedom for the unknown rest shapes, we use a fast heuristic that attempts to keep the rest shapes close to the registered geometry. While this process does add some indirection between fabric measurement and yarn simulation, it facilitates comparison and fitting of yarn parameters to the fabric response. You can find more details in the paper. We found that the standard discrete elastic rods model was not sufficient to fit our data. Motivated by the plated fabrics in our data, we added piecewise yarn stretching force. This models the distinct phases where first a stiff yarn unbuckles, and we mostly have the compliant yarn stiffness, and at some point the stiff yarn is stretched, and it dominates the composite stiffness. We apply a similar rationale to model contacts with an initially soft barrier for fuzzy fiber contact, and a stiffer barrier at stronger compression. We found that even with these nonlinearities in the yarn model, the complexities of real data and the uncertainties in the rest shape still make fitting across a large nonlinear stretching range a highly difficult problem. We therefore borrow terms from the fashion industry and define 2 regimes of cloth stretching. We define comfort stretch regime, which corresponds to everyday casual wear, and a power stretch regime corresponding to more active wear. Here's an example of a stress overstretch plot. Red is the target shell model and blue is the yarn fit. To the left of the vertical bar, we have the comfort regime where we really want to fit the fabrics well. And to the right, we have the power regime, which we would still like to fit well, but we weight the errors less. In this case, we managed to fit decently well across the entire range. In other cases, though, we found that giving priority to the comfort stretch was crucial in getting reasonable results at the expense of perfect fits in the power range. Now we'll take a look at our fitting results. I'll start with an error overview of our yarn fits across all 33 fabrics. This is a plot of the error with respect to stretching stress, and the errors are relative to the stress of the thin shell model in the comfort range. On the x-axis, 10 means 10% relative error, and the ticks are logarithmic. On the y-axis, we have the pattern names. We find that most of our fabrics actually have less than 10% error in the comfort range, which, given the difficulty of fitting yarn mechanics to real fabric, was a positive surprise to us. I'll also show the error with respect to orthogonal compression, and in this case, we mostly stay within 20% error. Now we'll compare some of these fabrics. First, let's walk through this single jersey 15 as an example. As we see from the topology here, in the schematic and photographs, this pattern is the basic plain knit, also called stockinette or jersey. And this particular fabric is made from a simple polyester yarn. Using the thin shell model, we can visualize a radial stiffness. From this, we see that the fabric has the expected anisotropy for the jersey, where it's compliant along 0 degrees and stiffer along 90 degrees. In the animations here, we can get some understanding of how the pattern topology generates anisotropy. The loops are such that at 0 degrees, it has an easier time pulling on adjacent rows. Of course, these were simulated with the optimized yarn coefficients. And here we have our yarn fits for stretching stress and orthogonal compression. We find a generally good agreement, except for the 90 degree stress error. For comparison, this was sort of an only okay result in the overview. You can find all the fitting plots in the supplementary document to get a more complete picture. Now we compare to a fabric with the same polyester-only yarn, but change up the yarn pattern to all needle instead. In the stiffness plots, we see this affects the anisotropy. Specifically, the all needle has a more pronounced difference between stiffness along 0 degrees versus along 90 degrees. In the animations, we compare the stretching of the different topologies in action. In this case, our fitting actually found similar yarn stretching and bending coefficients for the same underlying yarn, but in general, that's not always the case because of the complexities I've mentioned before. Still using the same polyester yarn, this Lynx fabric has a pattern topology that leads to a very unusual flipped anisotropic stiffness. It is more stiff along 0 degrees and compliant along 90 degrees. So just varying the yarn pattern alone has an interestingly complex material space. But even if we keep the same yarn and also the same pattern, there can be different fabric behaviors. In this case, we have two fabrics that differ just by the scale of their knit loops. The double knit interlock 11 on the right has loops that are about twice as large. As a result, it has a significantly boosted stiffness. So compared to the 150 Pascal on the left, we have 350 Pascal on the right. Finally, we can compare fabrics that have the same yarn pattern, but different yarn compositions and fabric coatings. The first fabric is the polyester-only version we've seen before. This single jersey 3 has the same pattern, but it has plated yarns combining spandex and polyester. And as a result, it has a surprisingly isotropic response. This single jersey 11 combines two polyester yarns in such a way that it becomes completely isotropic. Suffice to say that, from what we've seen, nonlinearity in yarn stretching forces were an important ingredient in fitting these complex behaviors arising from composite yarns. To summarize, we've built and published a dataset of production knit fabrics with diverse physical properties. We've demonstrated a first method for fitting yarn simulations to match the fabric stretching response, with some small modifications to the yarn model, and we applied it to our dataset. We hope that people find inspiration for future research towards a reliable connection between yarn and fabric mechanics. In the future, we hope that this pipeline could be extended to include cloth hysteresis and model yarn friction or fuzz. The dataset could be grown to include a wider range of fabrics, such as 3D woven or warp knitted fabric. And finally, this work can also be seen as a first step towards mechanical design of knit patterns, where learning the yarn parameters from some measured fabrics could aid in predicting the mechanics of new ones. And with that, I thank you for your attention.